Welcome back to the channel, everybody. I just took the part 107 exam and I passed with an 85%. So I wanted to run through some of the questions that I saw while it's still fresh in my memory. Starting with sectional charts, I don't know if there are 20 questions, but it sure did feel like there were 20 questions, maybe 15 or 17, but be very familiar on how to read sectional charts. On area 3 for figure 20, area 3, Elizabeth City Regional Airport, what is the ceiling of that airspace? So you would go to your chart supplement, look for area 3 and find the Elizabeth City Regional, and you're going to find that this is in Class D airspace. But what is the ceiling of it? We know that the ceiling of Class D airspace has to do with this number right here in this square, but we're going to add two zeros to it. So that's how we know that the answer is 2,500 feet. Now they're going to try and trick you. They're going to give you answers such as 700 above ground level, 2,500 feet AGL above ground level, or 2,500 mean sea level. So which one is it? So you have to know that for Class D airspace, it's given in mean sea level. So the answer is 2,500 MSL. By the way, they love figure 20. They love referring to figure 20. So I saw three or four questions with that sectional chart alone. What does a red flag on a sectional chart indicate? So go to figure 20, area 2, near Lake Drummond, and there's going to be a red flag icon. What does this mean? So basically, it's a visual indicator for pilots to be able to kind of check in, or they'll use it as a checkpoint, is my understanding. But the FAA wants you to know that there's going to be increased activity, flight activity in that area. There's a question on what airspace will you need authorization to fly. Two answer choices are going to be in shaded magenta. So you know that you're going to be in Class E airspace, which goes up to 700 above ground level, 700 feet above ground level. And there's going to be one that you have to look on your sectional chart to see where you're looking at. One of the airspace is going to be Class C. You definitely need authorization before flying in Class C airspace. What do the large blue markings indicate on a sectional chart? This should have said blue numbers. So these two numbers in front of us, 1-4, that's going to stand for the maximum elevation figure. What you do is you add two zeros to it. So in this case, it's going to be 1,400 feet maximum elevation figure. There's something in this quadrant of latitude and longitude that is 1,400 feet. Know what northeast, south, and west are. North is going to be 0 degrees, east is going to be 90, south is going to be 180, and west is going to be 270. They dropped the zeros on the 90, 180, and 270. So you're going to see 9 for east, 18 for south, and west, 27. There's a large blue circle that goes around with tick marks. That's your compass. I didn't know that when I was looking at it, and I think it was two nights before I figured that out. Use a paper to measure out 10 nautical miles from the scale on the chart. So go ahead and measure out 10 nautical miles. There's a scale on the top of the sectional chart, and the reason you want to do this is because you're going to be getting a question along the lines of, what airspace are you in 3 nautical miles southwest of this airport? And if you measure too far, if you guesstimate, oh, okay, well, that seems right. If you don't measure out exactly where they're talking about, I think it was 3 nautical miles, you could be in a different airspace. So 3 nautical miles, you might be in Class C airspace. But 10 nautical miles, you might be in Class D airspace. So something like that. So use that to your advantage. They give you a piece of paper and a pencil. And the scale is on top of the sectional charts. Not on all of them, but most of them have the scale on top. There's a question on, let's see, height of an unmarked balloon on figure 20, area 3. So let's go back to figure 20. Like I said, there's a lot of questions on figure 20. They're going to give you the general location of where they want you to look. So southeast of Elizabeth City Regional, what is the obstruction that you need to be aware of. So right here, there's going to be a remark. There's a box down here that says, caution, unmarked balloon on cable to 3008 MSL. And that's our answer, 3008 MSL. Answer choices were 3008 AGL, 3008 MSL, and then something else, like 700 AGL or something like that. So be aware of that. What happens when an airport closes that is usually in Class E airspace? So know what happens when an airport is part-time. What happens when it closes? Well, what airspace does it become? Regarding military operating areas, you can fly in the area, but use extreme caution. There was a question on remote ID. What's the purpose of it? It's basically to identify where the drone is. A lot of questions on drone regulations. Know the max weight of a drone under Part 107 that you can have. They're going to try and trick you on this one. The answer choices were 0.55 pounds up to 55 pounds, so 54.99 pounds and below, or 55 pounds and below that. So they're going to try and trick you. Questions related to alcohol. How long after a pilot had their last drink can they fly? And if a pilot is hungover the next morning and they're getting ready to fly their drone, what should they do? That was an exact question. Those are two questions right there that popped up on the test. So how long after a pilot had their last drink? It has to be 8 hours. And if a pilot is hungover, what should they do? They have a job to do. You should not be flying your drone if you're hungover because you're in an impaired state. There was a question on Part 107 is established for civil and public operations, or military operations. For this one, it was established for civil operations. There's a question on when does a drone not have to be registered? There's a certain weight that you don't have to register your drone, so be aware of that. If the visual observer took a medication that made them drowsy, what should you do? So you're on a job site and you have a visual observer, but they're feeling drowsy because they took a medication. Can you use them as a visual observer? No, you cannot, because they're in an impaired state. So either get a different visual observer, designate somebody else a visual observer, or wait, or basically do not proceed with the flight plan if the visual observer is impaired in any way. Who's responsible for everything that happens while flying the drone? The pilot in command. There's a question about what situation do you need to file a report to the FAA? You crashed your $1,700 drone. You damaged property that's worth $600 with a market value of $900. You damaged someone's property worth $400 with a market value of $700. The answer is, if you damage property that is greater than $500, not counting the cost of the drone, then you have to file a report to the FAA. In this case, they kind of threw you a curveball on this one because they started talking about market value. So I believe what they're trying to say is, if we replace it, it would be $700. But if we want to repair it, it would be $400. So I went with B on this one because it's greater than $500. If you caused $600 of damage to somebody's property with a market value of $900. So I went with B on that one. So what happens if you sell a drone to someone that is paired to your name? How long do you have to report an incident that causes more than $500 of damage to any property? Or if somebody loses conscience or gets very seriously hurt? That is within 10 days of the incident. There's a yield right-of-way to manned aircraft. Little plane gives way to bigger plane. Just remember that. There's a question on what should you do in the event that you see a plane in your visual line of sight and your drone is flying up there. Well, you would lower your drone elevation. What is the maximum height you can fly a drone in an area that has clouds 800 feet above ground level? The answer to this was 300 feet because the rule is you have to fly 500 feet below the clouds of the cloud ceiling. So 300 feet is the maximum height you can fly your drone. Question about max drone weight and how it affects flying. I'm not sure I got that one right. I have to look at the printout that they give you. There's a drone weight question and how it affects flying. Flying over people, know your categories 1 through 4. There was a question asking about category 4 operations. Can you fly 2 drones at the same time? No, you cannot. There was a question on invulnerability attitude, basically saying that it won't happen to me type of attitude. If there's no control tower, what frequency does the pilot use for a given airport? So go over your CTAFs, your UNICOM. What are all those airport frequencies used for? You'll be able to answer the question. There's a question on a foreign drone. I had to look this up afterwards because I wasn't sure if I got it right, but it was basically asking what conditions need to be met if you want to fly a foreign drone. Couple questions on center of gravity, so review that. Know what the angle of attack is and what happens when the angle of attack is exceeded for an airplane. The aircraft will stall. There's a couple questions on that. Know how to read MATAR and TAFs. Know how to find the wind direction and speed at a particular airport for a given MATAR. So in this one, this is the exact question that I had. What is the wind direction and speed at this airport? So you're going to go to this part right here is where it discusses the wind direction and speed. By the way, this is the date and time, 12th day of the month, 1845 Zulu time. That's what the Z stands for. And the next is the wind direction and speed information. 110 degrees is the, if you look at a compass, if 90 degrees is east, just past that is east-southeast. So you have a wind coming out of, let's just call it southeast, at 12 knots, okay? 12 knots. The G means gusting to 18 knots, all right? So on really windy days, you'll have gusts at 18 knots. So the answer is southeast wind of 12 knots gusting to 18 knots. Is there a question during what times will it become overcast at KOKC? Make sure you're looking at the right TAF, which is this one, and be able to tell when it will become overcast according to this TAF. There was a question on what abbreviation is used on the remarks part of the TAF. I did not study the remarks part very much, so you might want to review that because there was a question on that. I found the answer by looking at this figure 15 and looking for the answer choices, and CB kept popping up. Those are cumulonimbus clouds. I have one right here. And there's also one CB somewhere. There's two of them. Anyway, the answer was CB for cumulonimbus clouds. Know what a front is when it, regarding weather. Frost formation question, how does it form? And it's going to ask you characteristics of a stable air mass. What is it most likely to have? What characteristic? Showery, precipitation, turbulent air, or smooth air? And that's basically all the questions that I saw on the exam that I remember. A lot of sectional charts, lots of drone regulations, and some other random, you know, remote ID. And but if you aren't familiar with the sectional charts, study those, because the majority of the test, well, maybe not the majority, but a good chunk of the test is going to be testing you over sectional charts. Radio frequencies for airports. Know your radio frequencies for airports. What is a CTAF? What is a UNICOM? What is a ATIS? What is a Multicom? That sort of stuff. I did not see questions regarding airport signage. There's no taxi questions. There's no air traffic flow questions. So I did not see any airport traffic flow questions. You know, where's the aircraft in relation to the runway? If you have an aircraft that's about to land. I didn't get anything on airport windsock, landing indicator, nothing on that. I did not have to do any math. There were no load factor questions on my exam. Just some quick test taking tips. That's pretty much all the questions that were on the exam. But make sure you're looking at the correct figure, because there were probably about 4 or 5 times where I was not looking at the right figure and I could not figure it out for the life of me. So I checked the figure number at the bottom and it turned out that I was on the wrong one. So get a good night's rest. I didn't sleep very good before the test because I was nervous. So try and get a good night's rest. If your airman testing supplement pages are torn out, ask to see if they can have another one you can use, because you're going to be flipping back and forth between sectional charts, and it's really annoying to have these pages falling out of the supplement because they weren't physically attached to the booklet, okay? So there were about 5 or 6 pages that were not, they were in there, but they weren't physically attached, so that was kind of annoying. But I didn't notice it until I was in the testing on the computer. So I said, nah, you know what? It's not a big deal. I can deal with it. Okay. So you can bring a magnifying glass. Make sure it does not have a light. They won't let you use it if it has a light. And that's mostly for the sectional charts, because it's so small to even look at these. And there's so much information on there. They'll give you a calculator if you need it. Prepared. I mentioned earlier that you're going to be flipping back and forth to different sectional charts and figures. The test timer does not stop if you go to the bathroom. Okay, so just make sure that you do that before you go and start the test. Make sure to turn off your phone. Any wallets, purses, watches are going to be put in a bag. So they will give you a printout before you leave. Make sure you don't leave without that, so you'll know if you passed or not. That's basically the Part 107 questions that I remember. So I hope this helped in giving you a few pointers on what to expect in the test. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section, and I'll do my best to answer all your questions. So I'll see you all in the next video.